Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Starting a Side Business While Working Full-Time, co-sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. My name is Sarah Adler, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenters today are Hoya couple Jason Levin, MBA 06, and Lori Mihalich-Levin, Law 05. Before we get started, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. First, this webinar is being recorded and will be made available to all registrants within 3 days of this broadcast on our YouTube channel. Additionally, I will be passing along the link to the recording of this presentation in my webinar follow-up email. Second, questions are welcome throughout today's webinar. Please type them in the questions area as you have them in real time throughout the presentation. I will hold on to all questions until Jason and Lori have finished their presentation, and we'll begin the Q&A session during the last 10 to 15 minutes of the webinar. Third, we will be using the polling function of GoToWebinar today, so please do take just a few seconds to participate in the polls that we launch at the beginning of the webinar. And finally, if you have any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the questions area of the GoToWebinar system. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenters. Lori Mihalich-Levin, JD, is the founder of Mindful Return, a program that helps employers retain their new parent talent and helps new parents navigate the transition back to work after parental leave. A healthcare partner at Dentons US LLP, she is also mama to two wonderful redheaded boys, ages 5 and 7. Lori holds a law degree from the Georgetown University Law Center and completed her undergraduate studies at Princeton University's Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs. She is author of the book, Back to Work After Baby, How to Plan and Navigate a Mindful Return from Maternity Leave. Jason Levin founded Ready, Set, Launch, LLC after a career in brand management at Unilever, consulting at Accenture, and employer branding at Vault.com. He helps his clients execute successful business development strategies to find their personal brand, get a promotion, land that next job, and make a career change or transition into retirement. Jason also enjoys speaking on and moderating panels and presenting career and business development seminars and webinars at staff retreats, conferences, and training sessions. Jason and Lori, we're so eager to get started, so I'll turn things over to you two now.
Thank you, Sarah.
Great, thanks, Sarah. Would you be able to run the poll questions for us now, please, so we can get a good sense of where everyone in the audience is coming from?
Yep, absolutely. So everyone, I'm going to launch the first question. This is just to get a sense kind of who we have with us today. The question is, what degree did you receive from Georgetown? So just take a couple seconds to answer the question. Leave it open for a couple more seconds. And I'm going to close it. And the results are, so 43% of everyone attended, they received their undergraduate degree from Georgetown, 15% received their law degree from Georgetown, 15% received their MBA from Georgetown, 20% received a graduate degree from Georgetown, and 7% received a different kind of degree, so another type of degree. And our second poll is going to be, how many years of work experience do you have? So again, just take a couple seconds, leave it open for a little longer. Awesome, I'm gonna close it now. So we've got 12% have 0 to 5 years of experience. 6 to 15 years of experience is 47% of our listeners. 16 to 25 years is 18% of our listeners. And 26 or more years of work experience is 22% of our listeners. And one more. Thanks so much for your participation, everyone. Last one. What's the biggest issue taking your side business to the next level? I'll leave it open for just another couple seconds. All right, closing it now. Thanks so much. All right, so 26% said they just don't have the bandwidth. 6% said now is not a good time to start something new. 32% said I'm not clear on what type of business to start. 10% said I'm afraid to fail. And 26% said all of the above. Thank you so much, everyone, for participating.
Great. Thanks so much, Sarah, for running the polls. And it's a pleasure to be here with all of you. Thanks for sharing a little bit about yourselves. Before we kick off officially, Jason and I want to share just a little bit more about ourselves. I am Lori Mihalich-Levin, and I did, in fact, start a business while working full time. I began Mindful Return, a program that helps new parents return to work after maternity leave and now paternity leave as well, while I was working full time at a healthcare trade organization. And now I'm a partner at Dentons, and I'm on a 60% schedule. And the other 40%, I run Mindful Return and have written this book, Back to Work After Baby. And really, I was motivated by the fact that there seemed to be a curriculum out there for everything baby related, how to puree baby food, how to make a birth plan, all of that, but not how to plan and navigate your return to work after parental leave in a way that helped you feel more empowered and less likely to go off the rails. Turning it over to Jason to tell a little bit about himself.
Well, thank you, Lori. I guess in a lot of ways throughout my career, I started to recognize what people were coming to me for beyond my day job. And often people were asking me for their advice on how to sell something internally or getting advice on their own career. And so I started to recognize that this is something I could be doing outside of my day job. And so I too started my own side business. My side business clarified while working at Unilever when I was working on Dove lotions and creams, anti-aging lotions and creams, where I started to recognize that that business decisions and purchase decisions and personal brand decisions and career decisions were really around making a purchase. And people make purchases on why people get hired and why people win work and why people make career moves. And so while I was working at Vault, I was taking that personal brand approach on the side and actually running a remote sales team. And on the side, while I was working for Vault, people were coming to me for advice on careers and starting businesses and growing their practices. And so I've been out of my own now for almost 7 years with Ready, Set, Launch LLC. And today's agenda is really going to be around how do we get all of these ideas that you have and getting them to life. So we're going to talk a little bit about entrepreneurship and what we think is a great definition of entrepreneurship, and then really hitting on the key issues that will get your side business to the next level. Mindset, what is the side business? We have 32% that said they're not clear on what type of business to start. And that's something that's fairly common. Making time. We all know that time is really important. How do you bring time into this side business? Making a plan and getting it launched. And so what are the key things that you need and how do you get this off the ground? We'll be happy to take questions. We'll try to take as many questions as we can. Sarah had said earlier, please filter your questions through the chat room, and she's going to try to get to as many questions as possible. And certainly, you don't bring people on that advise on these topics if you're not willing to do some homework. So we're going to offer up some homework at the end.
Great. So let's first talk about what entrepreneurship is. I'm a risk-averse lawyer type who definitely never thought she was going to start a business. But Seth Godin, if I don't know if you know him at all, clarifies what exactly entrepreneurship is in a way that I really, really like and that really resonates with the past couple of years since 2014 that I started Mindful Return. I'd say, first of all, if you're not signed up for Seth Godin's daily emails, they are great little motivators that kind of keep me clear each day on what to focus on in my business. So what do people do when they're acting like entrepreneurs? Well, first of all, they make decisions. And I guess just zoom out for 1 second. You can act like an entrepreneur in whatever job you have. Or you can act like an entrepreneur by starting a business. But I think this is a mindset. And if you can check these things off as things that you can do, then you are absolutely capable of being an entrepreneur. So you make decisions. There's no one else around to make them. It's kind of the beauty of running your own business, right? You don't have to report up to someone or get permission or clear red tape. No, it's all you, which can be daunting, but also sort of exciting. Entrepreneurs invest in activities and assets that aren't a sure thing. Did I know that there were going to be people who wanted to learn how to go back to work after parental leave? No, but I thought that there would. So you don't know for sure until you give it a try. Entrepreneurs persuade others to support a mission with a non-guaranteed outcome. Here we are in this not a sure thing anymore. But really the power to convince others that what you're doing is worthwhile. And then fourth and finally, this is the most amorphous, says Seth Godin, most difficult to pin down and thus the juiciest. Entrepreneurs embrace, instead of running away from, the work of doing things that might not work. So you might see a theme here. Nothing is guaranteed in entrepreneurship land, but if you have these four qualities, then I say by all means, go for it. Seth also says, as far as he can tell, that's it. Everything else you can hire. So that should give you some reassurance that, oh, you don't have the skill or ability to design a logo, or you don't know how to use WordPress or whatever. Everything else you can figure out or hire. It's really about the mindset.
And so piggyback off of what Lori's saying, mindset is everything in starting a side business. And so when I think of mindset, and you know, there are even times when I have self-doubt, I go directly to water boy, you can do it. And, you know, that's the thing that needs to be ringing through your ears when, you know, it's been 6 months and a client hasn't come in yet. You need to believe that you are the person that's going to get this successful side business off the ground. As Lori was talking about earlier, there's nobody else to report to but yourself. You're the CEO of this. And so it's that consistent belief that you have the skills and the abilities to get this off the ground. And so with that mindset also comes action. So now is the time to get this off the ground. You wouldn't be on this webinar if you didn't think that there was something that you could be doing. And I can't tell you how many times people have come to me and said, I've read books and I've seen webinars and I still haven't done something. And so this webinar is going to get you to that very first step of just starting. So today, now, you're the person who's gonna begin and take that first step.
Speaking of steps, I am all about baby steps. I mean, I'm a mom who has 2 kids at home and a partner in a law firm, and I've got this business. Like, it's all about doing things in a tiny way over time. So the equation here, well, first of all, we've got the zebra, right? Everybody's got to learn how to walk. It's okay if you're wobbly at the beginning of running a business. But persistence, a little bit every single day, plus patience, something I tend to lack and recognize that in myself, I want everything to happen fast and now, but you know, running a business has taught me more about patience, as has having children. But you combine persistence with patience and you get progress over time. So when I first had this idea to create an online program for new moms, it took me about 4 or 5 months to develop this course that I wanted to create because I had no time. I had an infant and a 2-year-old and a job. But in carving out 20 minutes a day, you can get really far over just a couple of months. And we're going to talk more about the time management piece in a couple of minutes.
So first and foremost, you need to recognize that you are not alone. You're going to need a fan club, because to be able to do this yourself and work full time, it's just not going to happen. And recognize that the statistics bear out that no successful side entrepreneur or regular entrepreneur actually did it themselves. There's an organization that actually tracks entrepreneurship. It's called the Global Entrepreneurship Monitor. And the recent statistics show that successful entrepreneurs actually reach out to their friends and family. 85% of successful entrepreneurs got successful seed capital from friends and family. 66% of entrepreneurs actually start the business in their own home. And 25% have family as unpaid staff. And I'm proud to say that Lori is my unpaid staff member.
And I'm proud to say that Jason is my unpaid staff member. So we definitely help one another. Positive support builds continuous momentum. There are highs and lows in running your own business, just as there are in any part of life. And having that positive, supportive community around you, whether that's through coaches or groups that can offer you advice, can really help move you along. So just as an example, there are a couple of groups that I've been fortunate enough to participate in. There's a mompreneur meetup group that I've gone to and gotten some really helpful information from in the DC area. There's a DC birth workers group. Any place where, you know, the subject matter would overlap with what I'm working on in my business is a great place to go get ideas and get support from others who are in the same space. With your business, you'll have the opportunity to diversify and expand your skill bases. And first, I'd like to say that one of the things that I really love about having a day job, so to speak, and having a business is that it uses really different parts of my brain. And having a side business has taught me a lot of things that I wouldn't necessarily have learned through my legal work. So, you know, legal part of the day, I'm doing the analytical reasoning and the thinking for clients and strategizing. And then over on my business side, I'm using really different skills. I'm blogging and supporting a community and learning about WordPress and SEO, search engine optimization, and all that sort of stuff. And, you know, there are things that you won't have any idea how to do. I didn't know how to set up a MailChimp email list or anything that you will just have to figure out as you start your business. There are also things that you will not either want to or be capable of doing yourself. What I wasn't going to be able to design a logo, for example, that's just not in my wheelhouse, in my skill set. And you'll need to figure out what you need to pay for and use your resources to figure out who is best positioned to provide you that support.
So then it becomes a function of what is my side business? And so really I've got a three-step process to help people figure out how do you take your ideas into a business. We're not talking about some elaborate business plan. We're not talking about seed capital from venture capitalists or angel investors. We're talking about a very quick, simple way of getting your ideas onto paper and seeing what it could be. So the first is, let's take a look in the mirror. You've got knowledge and experience and skills and interests. And as I was saying earlier, often in my career, people were turning to me for advice on business development or how to sell things internally, or what they should be doing with their careers. And so these data points over time started to recognize for me that I was actually good at this and that I was actually interested in it. So there's plenty of things you're good at that drain you and fatigue you. Those are called weaknesses. Things that you're good at that get you excited are your strengths. And those are the things that you need to be focusing on. So this should take about 15 or 20 minutes to jot those things down. The second thing is, okay, so what is it that could be your business? Well, right now, you're noticing things out there that are just, I can't believe that we have to wait in line for the movie theater. And then Fandango happened. So any type of problem that exists, no matter how large or small, folks that, you know, have special diets like gluten-free and we're coming up with special types of gluten-free products. So you probably understand different types of problems that exist in the marketplace and specific consumers that are impacted by this problem. And you've been saying probably to yourself, you know what, if I could solve this problem, this is how I would do it. And so this is your one pager. Here's how I identify the problem. And here's the consumer that could be purchasing this, this potential solution. So problem, consumer, and solution.
Yeah, just to, I guess, a few words in terms of a case study. For me, the problem was I'm a mom. I've come back to work after maternity leave, and mom after mom is coming into my office, shutting the door, saying how hard it is, bursting into tears, talking about this transition that is remarkably difficult and kind of suffering through it myself, and saying, okay, so why isn't there a course that can teach people some skills to be able to go back to work in an easier way? And then I had my lovely encouraging husband say, well, what are you going to do about that problem? So for me, then the consumer was the new parent, the person who's struggling to transition into working parenthood. And my solution was to design a course that also provided an online community for people to be able to connect who are all going through this at the same time. So this was definitely generated from a sense of, man, I wish XYZ existed.
So you've got this concept on a piece of paper. Your very next step is actually to do a focus group and to get feedback from people that could be in a position to buy your product or service. And what this initial focus group can do is get you out of your own head to help you better define, well, wait a minute, I know that you think the problem is this, but here are some other nuances around the problem, and here's some other ways that you can modify this concept that would better align with people that would actually want to buy it. And then how is it that you can mitigate these information gaps? So you're only as good as what the people that would purchase your products are. So where other places can you get and become continually aware of the marketplace and how they view this problem?
Right, so again, by way of case study in terms of getting feedback, one of the first things that I did when Mindful Return was still in its infancy was to gather a group of maybe 15 new working moms to our house for brunch. It was easy to find those new working moms because I happened to be in that cohort. So they were my friends and colleagues and peers. And I had them over for a few hours to really brainstorm with me around the issues that needed to be addressed and what the course should look like and where I should be marketing and the tone I should be taking and all of that sort of thing. And I think another important place to get feedback is by offering your product or program for free to individuals who can provide you feedback and testimonials and, you know, ways that you can improve it. So, you know, very early on, I was having new working parents take my course just to give me feedback on it. And even now, I invite every employer who offers this program to their employees to try one for free so that they can get feedback on how the program works for their own employees. So that feedback loop, I think, needs to be continuous, basically from the first day you start your entrepreneurial venture and pretty much every day after that. All right, now we're going to move on to that question of how to make time. 26% of you said that you don't have bandwidth to start a business. And I agree, life is full. And in terms of figuring out how to make time for your business, I'd say before we talk about all those ninja strategies for carving out time, I want to focus on the fact that no is not a bad word. And in order to make time for this thing that you really want to do in your life and prioritize, there are probably some things that you'll have to turn down and say no to. There's a wonderful book Greg McKeown wrote called Essentialism. And in that book, there's a wonderful quote that I borrow from him on a regular basis, which is, if it's not a hell yes, it's a hell no. So in deciding what you're going to be doing with your day, think really hard about how you're spending your time and how you're spending your energy. Are you spending 20 minutes a night surfing Facebook? Maybe, and maybe that's totally fine. And if you want to carve out time to get a business off the ground, maybe those 20 minutes could be used to start the business instead. So now we're going to talk a little bit about some time management skills, aka how I started a business with two small children at home and working full time. The first one is go to bed. And I know it's really hard. We've got a million things to do, and we have small people who sometimes cut us up in the middle of the night, etc. But if you're not getting a sufficient amount of sleep, then you're no good to your business, you're no good to your day job, your family, et cetera. So I'd say prioritize rest. It will make you more thoughtful, creative, and efficient during your waking hours. Next, if you haven't heard of the concept of a Pomodoro, I just want to take a moment to explain that. Pomodoro is a technique that's based on that Italian tomato, where you might have seen the kitchen timers that are shaped like a Pomodoro tomato, and you turn the timer and it, you know, dings once it finishes the time. And here the idea is that you set a clock for 25 minutes and you focus on one problem, one issue, one thing that you're working on. You turn off all your email, you turn off everything else, and then you take a 5-minute break to wander around, check email, go to the bathroom, whatever. And then you go back and do another 25 minutes. So I guess I'd challenge you that if you can do a Pomodoro every night, you know, you can get your business to go a long way in a couple months of time. I'd also encourage you to really think hard about your prioritization list. So before you go to bed, before you wind down, can you come up with the 3 things that you intend to work on tomorrow? Or maybe that's just one thing, but whatever it is, figure out how much time you're going to allot to it, and then, you know, measure out how much time you're going to spend and then commit to it the following day, whether that's following up with a particular prospect or writing part of a blog post or working on a product concept. It helps to lay out the baby steps, the very specific next things that you have to do, and then commit to doing those things. Finally, calendar blocking is really critical here. If it's on the calendar, it happens, right? If it's not on the calendar, it doesn't happen. So to the extent you can actually carve out the time and say what you're going to do when and put it on the calendar, that helps. 2 additional thoughts there. One is I usually take that tomorrow list, so the 3 things or 1 or 2 things that I'm going to focus on, and I put it in an Outlook calendar appointment. Sort of as the title of the Outlook calendar appointment. So I know after the kids are in bed from 9 to 9:30 tomorrow, I'm going to do A, B, and C, just so I don't lose track of it. And it's already associated with the time of day. The other thing that I found, kind of my sneaky amounts of time that I found, have been on business travel. I've done some amazing amounts of work, you know, on a long airplane ride where I'm not connected to internet or anything. I've been able to take a couple of hours when I'm away from everything and knock out a big chunk of the course I'm writing or write a couple of blog posts. So I try to find that time that would otherwise just perhaps go missing and devote it to my business.
So you've got your concept, you've got your feedback, you've got your time management strategies. So what are the things that you need to be thinking about on a month-on-month basis to make sure that you've got a dashboard to make sure that you're going in the right direction? Quick MBA 101 lesson. I've got 2 favorite frameworks that I like to think about, not only in my own businesses, but the people's businesses that I'm working with. And the first is keeping focus via the 3 C's. And the 3 C's are consumer, company, and competition. The reason that people are successful is that they understand their consumer better than everybody else. What is their ability to pay? And what is the purchase decision going to be made? Is it one person? Is it multiple people? What types of budgets do they have? Their company, and you are your own company. So what are the assets that you're going to be bringing to bear so that you can get this, this product or service out there? And then competition. So successful entrepreneurs are not acting in the absence of competition. Actually, competition is a very good thing. Because if you have competition, that means people have options and choices, and you get a chance to talk about your points of differentiation. And so how do you think about your points of differentiation is via the 4 P's. The first is your product. So how does the consumer currently view the products that are available in the marketplace, and what does yours provide that's new, that's unique, that's different, that's valuable to your target consumers? Lori was talking earlier about price. When you're getting things out into the marketplace, you might charge a little bit below market. You might even give things out for free to actually build that momentum. And price is definitely a useful tool. And as people start to recognize, wow, this is really useful, and you start getting feedback, I would actually pay more for this, over time, you start to raise your prices. Promotion. So then as you start to think about who knows you, and I will say right now, there are more people that don't know what you're doing than do know what you're doing. And so promotion, self-promotion is not a dirty concept. It's just making people aware of what you're doing, and it's those target consumers that you care about. So we're not talking about blanket promotion, but specific sub-segments and raising awareness of what you're doing to those people and being able to get that product or service into their hands and then becoming raving fans of you. And then place is all about distribution channels. Are they physical distribution channels? Are they digital distribution channels? In 2018, they've become blended. But in a lot of ways, what are the channels that are going to be you're going to be targeting your potential consumers with? So then, yes, more market research. And Lori was talking about this. So as you get closer and closer to your success, you're actually going to understand your consumer and your buyer and your referral sources really well. And let me tell you, sometimes the consumer and the buyer are not the same people. You take laundry detergent, or you take buying alcohol, or you take any type of product. Sometimes the person that's buying it is actually not the end consumer. And then you start to think about how is it that you're reaching your target consumer via referrals.
So just in terms of case study, my consumer is new parents, but new parents aren't always my buyer, right? So sometimes the new parents are purchasing this program for themselves because they know they need it. But oftentimes the buyer is an employer who wants to retain the new parents as employees and then is offering the new parent to the parent. And so the new parent isn't actually paying anything to obtain my product. I'd also say in terms of referral sources, you may think you know who some good referrers would be at this point, just as you're brainstorming your business, but those referral sources are likely to evolve over time and you're likely to develop more intel about them as time goes on. So for example, I discovered through some of the moms who are signing up for my course that perinatal psychologists had discovered Mindful Return and were offering or telling people that they should take it as a way to help themselves provide, get some postpartum support. I didn't know that though until someone in my course said, oh, my therapist told me that I should take this. And once I discovered that as a referral source, then I was able to use it by getting connected with more perinatal therapists, et cetera. So once you learn these nuggets, you can then act on them and grow out your network within that type of referral source.
And then from your own customers and the feedback they give you, you start to recognize the benefits that they value, and that gets transferred into how you talk about yourself on your website, the things that you blog about, your social media approaches, your brick approaches. And then you start to understand what is the real market for these benefits. And sometimes you have a primary consumer, but then you start to learn that there are secondary consumers that also value what you're doing.
Yeah. Also in terms of a case study, when I'm thinking about the benefits that I wanted to provide and then learning more about what benefits I was providing, I intended to provide a curriculum and information for these new parents going back to work. But then I discovered that perhaps even more important to the new parents than the information that I was providing was the fact that I had built a community for the new parents. So the fact that they got to know their peers who are all transitioning back to work at the same time was in fact a benefit that, you know, I probably wouldn't have ranked as the top benefit that turned out to be the top benefit. So going back to the concept that as your business evolves and you get smarter about who your consumers are and what the benefits are, your approaches will change over time too. So now we want to touch on a couple of the nuts and bolts consideration for the side business that you'll need to think about and that don't necessarily fit into some of these broader categories. But it's likely that despite wearing many, many, if not most or mostly all of the hats in your business, there are some folks that you want to consult with for professional advice. For example, You probably want to touch base with a certified public accountant at some point, your tax advisor. You want to be thinking about whether this really is a business or if it's a hobby, because that can have serious tax implications. You'll want to go down to the bank and set up a business bank account for your own business so that you can keep it separate from your own finances if it's a solopreneur venture that you're running. And so you'll probably want to get some help on the financial side. You'll probably want to consult with an attorney early on to help you get incorporated properly in whatever jurisdiction you're intending to set up business. This doesn't have to be an extensive engagement, and there are attorneys out there who are really adept at helping to set up businesses, fairly quickly, but it's something you probably want to get help with rather than just going online and uploading a document. A graphic designer was something I discovered I needed early on, just to help me out with logo and the design of my website, that sort of thing. Website and email, you will probably need some help, unless you are a designer yourself, getting a website together that looks nice and is appealing, etc. I think I started out simply with a WordPress blog that I did myself initially, and then at some point it made sense to hire a web designer to expand it a bit. In terms of email, I'd say one mistake I made early on was not switching to an @mindfulreturn email address sooner. I was going along happily at mindfulreturn@gmail.com, not realizing that it was actually really, really easy to go set yourself up with an email extension that matches the name of your business. And so I'd say that's something you can do easily and really early on to establish credibility with your brand. I'd also do a plug for a great tool, a great company called Wise Stamp, WISESTAMP, which helps you to put really beautiful signature blocks onto your email. So for example, I put the image of the cover of my book into my email signature for my business and that sort of thing. And you can attach it to pretty much any email server. All right, so now it's time for takeoff. Jason.
So it's really about building your brand. And building your brand is, and recognize that a brand in its classic definition is a delivery of a promise. You are delivering a promise of an experience or a service. And so how people consume not only your personal brand, but your actual brand is extremely important and actually very consistent. And so Lori's going to talk a little bit more about how she used her brand to get Mindful Return off and running.
Right. So back to what Jason was saying before about your brand and getting yourself out there and selling not being a bad thing. I definitely, as we go back to the risk-averse lawyer thing, had a hang up around, putting my brand out there, who am I, blah, blah, blah. But really, if people don't know who you are, you can't help them. And so for me, it was really important to figure out how to get people to know what Mindful Return was and is. So the very first thing is to leverage your relationships. Talk to the people you know in your network, your family, your community, and let them know what you're up to, because they can be some of your biggest brand advocates from the very beginning. Content marketing, I think, is a really wonderful way to build your brand today, especially with the rise of the internet and online marketing. By blogging consistently, by having a newsletter, by writing for other people's websites and other bigger websites, I've really been able to grow my SEO, or a search engine optimization, so that people can find Mindful Return just through a basic Google search. It'll pop up when people type in things like maternity leave, et cetera. I also can't underemphasize the importance of going to relevant events and industry professional associations. The first really big employer client that I landed was because I went to a Georgetown law event around women in the law. And there was a panel, and there was a woman on the panel talking about, gosh darn it, all these women, new moms, are leaving our law firm, and I can't figure out how to get them to stay. And I approached her afterwards and said, well, I run this program called Mindful Return. And lo and behold, she connected me to HR and boom, it was a benefit within a couple of months. And so I think had it not been that personal connection, I definitely wouldn't have had that opportunity. Engaging your referral sources. We talked a little bit about this, but really it's once you figure out who is likely to refer people to you, it's maintaining those relationships and building them. And, you know, I have lunch with doulas and therapists and find ways to maintain good, authentic connections to people who are going to be able to bring business to you. And finally, most importantly, word of mouth. Your happy clients will lead you to your future clients. They're the ones who go around spreading the word and raving about you day and night. And so the very, very best way to grow your brand is to do great work for the people you're currently working with.
And while you're doing this great work, dare I say that you will become more comfortable with, some might not be fully enamored with, but more comfortable with the concept of selling. And in certain worlds, it's called client development or business development. But in reality, selling is not a dirty word. And often I have a saying that we talk often about the bottom line, which is an accounting term for the very end of your net income after expenses and G&A and those types of things. But for me, selling is about the top line. And the bottom line is the top line. You have nothing to count if you have no top line. My favorite author talking about top line and selling is Daniel Pink's To Sell Is Human. And in his book, he was describing a wonderful case study where they looked at extreme extroverts, extreme introverts, and the people in the middle, the ambiverts. And the ones that sold the best were actually the ambiverts. Ambiverts are people that can speak and can listen. So actually ask a question, but not with the intent to talk like an extrovert would, and actually be able to carry on a conversation, not like an extreme introvert. And so many folks on the line here have the capacity to sell. What I say to you is that selling is process. Recognize that if you have a contact management approach, you're going to do very well in this three-step process: outreach, follow up, secure the meeting. So your rate of outreach needs to be higher than the actual meetings that you'll get. So if you have 5 outreaches for potential meetings, you might get 1 initial response. And so 20% response rate is actually quite good. So get ready for a little bit of loneliness. But that doesn't mean that the 4 other people don't want to talk to you ever. They just don't want to talk to you right now. So following up periodically, and what I mean by periodically is not every day, not every week. And I often say this, that stalkers go to jail, but persistent people get meetings. And so an occasional follow-up, maybe in a month, maybe in 2 months, you might find that person more receptive to meeting with you. And I'm talking about people that actually you currently know or you're being referred into. It's that hard to get those types of meetings. But if you're in a continual process of contact management, you're going to be out there securing those meetings and then being able to talk about what you're doing, as well as fully and completely understanding the need as it pertains to the person that's in front of you. Are they the decision maker that can purchase what you're offering? If it's an organization, are there multiple decision makers? What needs to be done to get all of those people on board? And often, a sales lead time or a sales cycle takes longer than you want. But remember, you're talking about a solution and you're listening to them on how they perceive it. From there, it's all about creating a tracking file to detail your progress. My favorite quote, if it's not written down, you don't know that you know it. And actually, good sales process is actually good sales tracking, where you're putting together your referrals, your prospects, your clients, and every single time that you have an interaction or an outreach, you're actually noting it in a file. So in the beginning, you can use an Excel file, a Word file, or a PowerPoint. After, you're probably going to get larger, a big fan of contact management systems. Aptivo is the one that I use. There's Contactually. There's a whole set of contact management systems out there for you to keep track of all the people that you're going to be interacting with. So get out there and enjoy the process, because you're going to be meeting a whole host of people. If you remember, your parents told you that there is stranger danger. Well, in your side business, actually, strangers are good things. So let's get out and meet some strangers.
Great. So we're going to leave you just with a few parting thoughts, then how to keep in touch with us. We'll take time for questions, and then we've got homework for you. So just start. Only you can get your side business off the ground. Remember, we said earlier that the definition of an entrepreneur was making decisions. The very first and most important decision you need to make is to go for it. To maintain momentum, you need to beware of time management, use those skills and techniques, and keep positive people around you who will help you through the lows, help you through the I can't do this, help you through the this is taking too long, and will motivate you to keep moving forward.
Remember that selling is listening. Make sure you're asking plenty of questions. Get beyond the elevator pitch, because in reality, the more that you understand how your potential customers perceive this, the more you're going to more likely get the sale. So ask questions just as much as you talk about yourself. And then follow up. Follow up. There is joy in follow up. You are the person who's most excited about your side business. And so it might take days, it might take weeks, it might take months. You're talking to somebody that's willing to wait years to get a meeting with somebody. And it's because of that joy and excitement. I once wrote a top 10 list to somebody about meeting with me because it had taken 18 months. And finally, he laughed and he actually met with me. So follow-up is something that's essential in a successful side business or an entrepreneurial venture.
And while you're waiting those 18 months, you do need to be patient. Results will come over time. And I can't emphasize enough the importance of visualizing the successful scenario. I think it's important to take some time to do some visualization work around your business and your life and really think about, sort of put yourself in the present tense a year or 18 months from now and say, my life looks like, my business looks like. And create a vision for what you're trying to achieve, because you're way more likely to get there if you can see it first.
Above all, be yourself to infinity. You are good enough. You are smart enough. Gosh darn it, people like you. They're not expecting you to be some superhero, just to hear about you and connect with you. So be yourself throughout this entire process.
We'd love to keep in touch with you. My email is listed here if you'd like to reach out. I have a weekly Saturday Secrets newsletter that comes out on Saturday morning for new working moms. You can find me on Twitter, like me on Facebook, and learn more about the mom and dad programs here. If you're an employer interested in thinking about offering Mindful Return to your employees, there's a special page for you listed at the bottom as well.
And so you can sign up for my blog at readysetlaunch.net. My email is here, and you can consider me as a potential speaker or panelist. Your business challenges, your business practice challenges. I've also done other webinars for Georgetown Alumni Career Services, such as Get the Meeting, Retirement, Personal Brand. And these are all relevant things to as you think about your side business. There's also some great Hoya resources out there beyond this webinar. Make sure to check out the HoyaPreneurs.org and the Georgetown Entrepreneurship Alliance. And actually, on the YouTube channel for Georgetown Alumni Career Services, there's actually a playlist specifically for entrepreneurship that you should check out. And now we'll take some questions.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jason and Lori, for sharing all of this with us. Everyone, please continue to send in questions that you have for these two. We've got a couple here, Jason and Lori. So to start us off, how do you cultivate a focus group in a new location? For example, moving to a new city where you don't know people, how would you get together a group of folks who you can run things by or test things out with?
Well, the first thing I would do is see if there's a Georgetown alumni group in that city.
Two things. First of all, I don't know whether the business is local, But I would say that your group for feedback need not necessarily be local. There's no reason, if you've got friends or colleagues or acquaintances all over the place, why not convene them for a feedback session by phone or by webinar or video conference? I think Jason's point is also well taken. Find your Georgetown folks. Maybe find the communities that are aligned with the type of business that you are planning to run, and just meet one or two people and ask them who they would bring in and ask, and it sort of grows as a web from there.
Great. Do you have any advice for folks who are struggling to find a good marketing agency with experience working with small businesses? How might they go about finding that type of agency, or maybe tailoring what it is they're looking for in order to find that support?
So I'd be reaching out to your small business peers in your community. There's listservs that are focusing specifically for folks in small business. You know, we were talking about earlier about the value of a referral. And so reaching out to your peers to see who they've used and who they've had success with should help you get closer to that marketing agency.
A question about your time management tips and tricks. Those were great. How do you still incorporate, like say you're someone who they still want to incorporate those 20 minutes of Facebook surfing or, you know, time for downtime or reading or, you know, personal time, working out, whatever it is. How do you advise that? Do you set timers for everything, or how do you navigate through all that?
Oh, that's a great question. And I mean, I'd be remiss if I didn't note that building self-care into one's day is, you know, one of my highest priorities and one thing that I talk about a lot in my own business. Yes, I think you need to figure out what energizes you and what recharges you, and don't let that fall off the priority list. If that means you have an hour between, you know, after work or when kids go to bed and you go to sleep, maybe you spend half an hour of it on your business and the other half doing that thing that recharges you. For me, especially when I was a brand new parent, it was really all about micro self-care. For example, I would, on my commute to work, I would take the metro, and then I had about a 7-minute walk between the metro and my office, and I carved out 5 to 10 minutes during that walk just to sit on a park bench, go into a hotel lobby, turn on Insight Timer, meditate, read a book. I find ways to fit those really critical components into my day, and then, you know, work on my business and other designated parts of my day. So I think it's about carving out the time and being intentional about how you spend it. And yes, don't put yourself at the very bottom of the priority list.
And Lori starts her day with half an hour of yoga. And for many years, I would just sleep through it. And after Lori would do her yoga, she'd wake me up. So another way that I found self-care in my world in 2018 is that Lori actually wakes me up at 6. So I wake up a half an hour earlier and I get a chance to do my morning exercise, which I'd been complaining about forever that I wasn't getting exercise into my day. And so I've actually found it on a daily basis by waking up a half an hour earlier.
Which, side note, we wouldn't have been able to do while the kids were still waking up 3 times a night. But now that they're sleeping through the night, it's more possible.
Yeah.
Super. Another question about time management. How do you manage too much time? For instance, if you're a consultant and you're super, super busy for several months in a row, and then you've kind of got a bunch of downtime all of a sudden, how do you manage that?
Yeah, that's a great question.
You know, and you're going to have those feast or famine moments. And so I think the important piece is that while you're delivering work, to make sure that you've got 2 or 3 business development priorities when things are not as quick, so that you've got the 5 referral sources that you need to reach out to, that blog post you've been meaning to write, so that you get back to focusing on the business. And one of the things I always encourage my consulting clients on is to track your referral sources. And over time, if you've tracked all your referral sources, then you have a list of all the referrals. And then in your downtime, you're reaching out to those referral sources to drum up business to get busy again.
Yeah. I mean, I experienced this in my legal practice too, right? You might be on with some really heavy projects and then off for a little while. And what do you do in that lull?
And I think for me, it's exactly having that list of things that you want to be able to work on. So, you know, I had a lull recently where I wrote an extra article that we published as a firm, and I prepared for a couple of upcoming talks that were a couple weeks off, but that I knew once I got slammed, I wasn't going to be able to spend time preparing for. So it's also a matter of sort of looking out over the horizon, seeing what's coming, and maybe advance loading some of the work so that when you do get busy, it's not falling off of your to-do list.
And then it's also about shifting locations. So there might be things that you just feel stuck on in your free time. So get out of your home office, pick a library, pick a hotel lobby, get into a coffee shop. Sometimes the change of scenery also will help you get more focused in that free time.
But, and I think the last point I'd like to make on the free time point is sometimes it's okay to have the lull and have the free time, right? Like that's when you can re-energize yourself. That's when new creative ideas will come to you. We don't have to fill every moment of every day to be successful. And sometimes the best ideas come when we have that white space.
Great. And then last question, because I know you have some homework for everybody. How early should you begin to think about revenue generation?
I mean, you need to think about revenue generation from day one. Whether you're going to be making money in the first year is the big question. And it's quite likely that you won't be making money in that first year because of all the investment in time and energy and those types of things. And things just cost money. So I think there needs to be a patience factor in year two, year three, year four, that you might be breaking even in year two or year three and may not generate revenue for a fourth year. And, you know, Lori was talking earlier about patience plus persistence equals progress, that, you know, over time you'll make money, but I highly doubt it in the first year.
Super. Thank you so much. I'll turn it back over to you guys to give out homework and close out.
All right. So this is everybody's homework, Sarah included. To be completed in the next 30 days, who's going to be in your fan club? What time will you carve into your schedule to work on this? What is that initial business idea or series of business ideas? So that's who's going to be in your fan club. What time will you carve into your schedule to work on this? What is the potential business idea?
Also, you want to be asking yourself, who's the consumer? Where are you going to go do market research? How are you going to reach out to them? And how are you going to be tracking your progress? I think the last thing I would like to note before we close out is that Jason and I do have a special opportunity to work with the two of us that's open just through this Sunday. So if that's something of interest, go to my blog, www.mindfulreturn.com. Click on the blog and find the most recent blog post on starting your own side business. And you can read more about that there.
So, and my parting thought is, yes, you can get started. You're on this webinar for a reason. And that means that you want to do something. So after you get off, please start answering these questions, find joy and incrementality, and make it happen. Hoya Saxon.
Thanks, all.
Thank you so much, everyone. Take care. Have a great rest of your day.